Okay, thank you, Mike. So I want to thank you, Alina and Mike, for invitation. I don't give much Zoom talk before, so I hope everything will work out fine. Okay, so today I'm going, so is this okay? Okay. So today I'm going to talk about Pissot's these rules conjecture, and especially for function field and also the formulation for complex. Okay, so today we'll first explain, recall a little bit what is Pissot's these rules conjecture, and then we'll talk about the function field formulation, and then we will mention what's the complex analog. And along the proof, we'll formulate a Diophantine equation on function field and also complex. And then finally, we will give an outline of the proof of this Pissot's conjecture for function field. Okay, and this is a joint work with my student and Jia Liang San, Ji and Ji Guo. Okay, so let's recall a little bit of what is linear recurrence. So a linear recurrence is a sequence of complex number, and then they satisfy some linear recurrence. Okay, so we will use we can write this sequence in the following form. So here are polynomial over C, and you plug in n, and this is some complex number and take to the nth power. Okay, so this is the general form to represent linear recurrence. Okay, so in particularly, we can go a little bit looser. We'll call this as an exponential polynomial. So for everything, here is a polynomial, here is some number to the nth power, and this type of thing in general is called an exponential polynomial in the number field side. And later I will explain what is exponential polynomial in the complex case. Okay, and on the conversely, whenever you have something represented in this form as an exponential polynomial, you can check it also defines a linear recurrence. Okay, so let's start with this Pissot's these roots conjecture. Sorry. Okay, so so let's begin with linear recurrence, and let's just say over a number field, and D is a positive integer bigger than 2, and suppose each term is a this power of some element in this number field for all but finite many n. And then you can find another linear recurrence A over algebraic closure of K, such that this Bn equal to An to the dth power for all n. Okay, so I want to brought your attention here is for number field, they need this assumption Bn is a dth power for all but finitely many n. And for function field, we can do better. Okay. Okay, so what about function field? So we begin with an algebraic closed field of characteristic zero, and then K is a finite extension. So we can find a smooth model, which we call a curve C, and the function field, K would be the function field of this smooth model. Okay, and let's denote G to be the genus of C. Okay, so let's make an observation first. So suppose we have two exponential polynomials. Okay, remember it's a polynomial times alpha to the n and take sum. So we have an exponential polynomial. And suppose this is Cn, everything is on the constant field. Okay. And then we notice in this case, because K is algebraic closed, so everything of Cn will be a dth power. So this an to be any exponential polynomial of a function field. And in this case, this is still an exponential polynomial, and every nth term is this power. Okay, so in other words, if we want to stay a Pissot's conjecture, we need to modify a little bit. So the following is the thing that we think should be adjusted to the following form. So suppose we have an exponential polynomial over function field k. And suppose bn is some this power. And I think for infinite many n would be enough. And in this case, we would find the exponential polynomial and also an exponential polynomial for constants, such that bn would be cn times an to the d. So in other words, unlike the number field case, you would need to make some adjustment of a constant term. Okay, so this is the thing that we think should be modified. Okay, and what the next is what we can do. Okay, so suppose bn is an exponential polynomial over function field. And let's take gamma to be the multiplicative group generated by roots of this linear recurrence. So it will be generated by B1 to BL. Okay, and then here we need to make some assumption for our method. So we will have to assume that this gamma, this multiplicative subgroup, when it intersects with this constant field, would be trivial. So later I will explain why we need this for our method. Okay, so under this assumption, so suppose bn is this power for infinite many n. And in this case, we can find an exponential polynomial, and also the adjustment will be a polynomial such that every term of b will be equal to qm times am to the d for all m. Okay. So this is what we can do. Okay, and so remember the key point here is we need to make some assumption. And also here we can do better than number field. The assumption only need for infinitely many n. Okay, so how about the complex analog? So it was developed independently, starting from Reed in the 20s. And this is a generalization. So we say an exponential polynomial in complex case, we say it's an order Q, and which is the following form. Here also the coefficient is a polynomial over C. Here is the exponential function. So it's exponential of some Q, some polynomial. Okay, and so this is, in the complex case, we call this exponential polynomial. And in the order Q is just take a maxima of all the exponent. So it's a maxima of degree of Q1 to Qm, okay. And the following is what we can do about this complex case. So for complex case, if you have an exponential polynomial order Q, and suppose F equal to G to the some this power of entire function. And in this case, G is also an exponential polynomial of order Q, okay. So for this type of result, actually, it's extend the result of Mike Green in the 70s. And in there, he tried to do some hyperbolic problem for complex analysis. Okay, so as you can see, this seems to be a good analog, right? Okay. So toward the proof of this type of thing actually related to some Diophantine problem. And so for the definitive problem, what we can say for function field is the following. So again, we have a polynomial, which is defined over the function field, multivariable. And suppose we have to rule out some possibility, right? So suppose it's not like this type of form, like a constant times monomial. This I is some, xi is some monomial product, and it's some this, times some this power. And if it, this is a, quite apparently this is something you should exclude. And so if you exclude this trivial case, then we have the following conclusion. So if you start with some units, this always means it's pole and zero lie only on S. Okay, so if these are S units, and suppose you then, and our result is that you can find some positive integer n, and then some number C1 and C2, and point is only depend on the D we want, and N degree F, and the height of UI. And such that, so suppose this F1L to FUL is this power in K, for some L is quite bigger than C1, C2, like we can find. And this height F is, this is a relative height of this polynomial. And if L is sufficiently large, and in this case, for sufficient large L, and if when you plug in this FU1L to FUN, it's this power. In this case, this U1 to UN must be multiplicative dependent over K. And moreover, we know exactly how to control this MI. So this M is something we can find. And this the absolute value of this M take sum has to be smaller than the number that we can control. Okay, so is this okay? Okay, so in other words, in this function field case, it simply tells us if you have some large exponent, when you take it in into this function, this polynomial, if it's this power, then it's impossible. It must be multiplicative dependent over K, and for some control the size. Okay. So now let's look at the complex case. For complex case, the related diophantine problem is the following. So let's take UI to be exponential of some polynomials. Again, D is some integer, bigger or equal than two. And then, because this has some geometric application, so we usually take a homogeneous polynomial. So suppose it's not this power. So suppose this polynomial is not this power. And suppose when you plug in 1, 0, 0, F001, the value is not zero. So this condition is geometry means, because this homogeneous polynomial will define a hypersurface. And this condition just tell you the hypersurface and the coordinate hyperplanes has to be in general position. Okay, so suppose we have this, and suppose we find this, we take units inside of F, and we find it's a G to the this power, which is some alpha to be polynomial. And in this case, we also can show that this exponential, this UI has to be multiplicative dependent modulo C. Okay, so this is the complex analog. Okay, so let me explain how to prove these things. Because for complex case, it's easier to explain. So let me first give an idea how we prove this type of result. So let's take a very simple polynomial. Let's take this example. So fx to be x0 squared plus xn to the square. Okay. And remember, ui is exponential to the qi, and take u to be u0 to un. Okay, so what is the key point here? So let's take a differentiation of ui prime and then over ui. So if my calculus is correct, it should be qi prime, right? So which is a polynomial? Okay, which is at the most a polynomial. But what is ui? Ui is exponential of a polynomial. So you know the growth of ui would be so much bigger than qi prime. So the key point is this thing is small with respect to ui. Okay. So the next thing is let's try to define a polynomial which has a small coefficient. So we will take this f. So the idea is, so let me do this first. So the idea is we want to define some polynomial. Then when you take a derivative of fu prime, it's actually equal to this polynomial plug in u. So how do we do it? So it's very easy. Here, you just take a derivative of x0 to square. So you would, and then plug in u0, sorry. So you will get this part. So let's take this as a coefficient and then still use x0 squared. And then you can check exactly it satisfies this condition. Okay. So the point here is now we construct another multi-variable polynomials with a small coefficient. And then when you plug in u, you get the derivative of the original fu. That's the main point. Okay, so now let's see if you have, so for example, if you have fu to be g to the this power. Okay, and so because fu prime would be d times g prime times g to the d minus one. So in other words, this g will divide both, you will divide fu and also divide, it will also divide this value. So in other words, g would be a common zero of this polynomial and another polynomial plugging u. Okay. So this is the main point. So now you have two multivariable polynomial, and one is a constant coefficient, one is not constant coefficient, but the coefficient is small growth. And then you know, and you we know for this type of polynomial, if you plug in units, then their GCD is small. Okay, so this is a result of so suppose u0 to un are multiplicative independent modulo c. Okay, and then this is the result with Levin. We have a GCD theorem, and our result also has has a slow growth moving target. In other words, exactly if the coefficient of du is smaller than u. Okay, and then the GCD is small. So and remember, G divided both of them. So this tells us if GCD is small, then F has to be small. Okay, but on the other hand, we all know that because this is for if G to the this power satisfies this type of equation, and it's very easy to see the growth of G is exactly the growth is. Maxima of the growth of u0 to un. So in other words, the height of g is large because of this in general position assumption, but it would contradict our GCD result because g has to be small. Okay, so this is very simple-minded thinking of how to do this. I think this idea has been there since Green and Kovacs-Lanier, but at that time they don't have a GCD. But now we have a GCD, so this can actually put into work. Okay. Okay, so how about function field? Okay, so let's take the same example. And we like to write affinity for function field. Okay, so we have some S unit for this U1 to UN, and we have some large L. So the key point is, again, for key point, remember what we want to plug in now, we want to plug in UI to the L's power. So let's take a derivative. And so this looks bad every time we need to take a different L, right? But it's okay. So the derivative doesn't change so much. We just have some constant multiple of UI prime over UI. But what is the height of UI prime over UI? So if you think about UI is a polynomial, and when you take a derivative and you divide by UI, then we know the only zero can occur would be when UI has zero, and the only pole comes from the zero of UI and the pole of UI. Moreover, it's only this, only simple zero and simple pole. In other words, the height, the pole can, every pole here is simple. When you take about polynomial, all the poles are simple, and it only comes from zero and the pole. In other words, the height will be bounded by this the distinct zero and pole. So in other words, here it's at the most twice of the height UI. And because it's a function field, you need to make some adjustment on differentiation. So here the correcting term is 3G. Okay, so so for function field, this is what I say. So you need to take a different local parameter, and then for this here, the zero and the pole comes from the zero of UI and the zero pole of UI, and they are simple. And for here is the thing you need to adjust. Okay, so that's why you get 3G. Okay, and here T is, in general, we take, when you take U prime, is you take du over dt. Okay, sorry, that's a lot of notation. Okay, so now, so we also want to define what is DLF. So UI are fixed, so I write the arrow here. So similar idea, we do the same thing, okay. And so when you plug in U1 arrow to U1 arrow, then you get the DLF. Okay, so again, then you are considering the GCD of this polynomial and the F, okay. And so in other words, we need to estimate the GCD of F and this DFL. And what about this DFL? So it depends on L, but if you look at our formulation here, so their derivative actually only, the L only comes from, only on the coefficient. So it does not affect the height of the coefficient. Okay, so in other words, for the function field case, we need to deal with some GCD, and moreover, the GCD of F. So we need to deal with GCD of many couples. And then for this part of GCD, the invariant is the height of the coefficient is fixed. Okay. Okay, so, but the bad news is we don't have a GCD in a multivariable of this form yet. So we only have result for n equal to 2 by Kovacs and Zania. So in other words, we need to work out another GCD theorem. Okay. Okay, so the GCD theorem is the following. So for the function field case, so we have two polynomials and they are coprime, non-constant. Okay, so again, similarly, we fix epsilon greater than zero. And there's always, we can find an integer m and then real CI. Everything is effectively and depend only on epsilon. Such that when you give all the n tuples, so suppose the height is, so it's suppose that the height is very big, then in this case, we will have some of the tuples would have, so remember in the complex case, we would go directly say they are multiplicative, dependent over constant. But in function field case, we cannot do that, but we can say the height is bounded. Okay, so this is something different. And but also this exponent can be bounded, and m is something we can find explicitly. And suppose it's not this case. Suppose not this case. Then we have GCD bound. Okay. So actually, I don't like this formulation too much because it kind of anyway. You don't feel it's complete, but let's look at the thing we want to apply. So when we want to apply this theorem, we want to apply to L to be a large power. So in other words, when L is large enough, this equation is always correct. So we don't have this one. And so, but and then when L is large, if this is not constant, then the height would also go very big, greater than L. And so, in other words, this one will fail. So in that case, we will really GCD theorem only this hold. Okay. So, but that would rely when L is very large. So in other words, we will have the following asymptotic formulation. So again, f and g are polynomials over function field. And so we have some, so here we don't need to, because it's a fix, we just say we have something non-zero. And in this case, again, we find the m and c1, c2. So the point is, if you have a sufficient large n, large l, okay? And in this case, for sufficiently large L, either you have G1 to Gn are multiplicatively dependent over K, or you have GCD bound. So the GCD is small. Okay, so so I don't like the previous version, but this version is okay, it's fine, it's the thing we can get. Okay, so for GCD theorem is, for function field, I think it's kind of fascinating. Like for function field case, sometimes for GCD, you can find the uniform bound. And so for example, so Alina also have some result to have uniform bound for GCD of function field. But here it's not uniform. Here it's dependent on GI. So, but I think to find the uniform bound should be very hard. Okay, so finally, let's talk about how this GCD theorem, how this Diophantine equation formulation for function field can help us to find the function field pixels. Okay, so let's remember what do we want to do. We have some linear recurrence, and when you plug in n, every term is an nth power. Okay, and then we want to find the, we want to say, oh, actually you can find another linear recurrence, and so bn would be some an to the d and times some polynomial. Okay, so So that's what we try to do. So let's begin with this linear recurrence. So this is the thing we are given. Okay. And here, so we'll take, let's choose U1 to UN to be basis of this gamma generated by the roots of B. Okay. So then in other words, in this formulation it's standard that we can find the Laurent polynomial. And so here is the polynomial type. Okay, so such that Bm would be equal to this Laurent polynomial and to the Fm, to the U1m, to the Unm. Okay, and then you can kill out you can take out all the denominator. And it doesn't affect our result. So let me just say, let's assume F is a polynomial. Okay, so now we have Bm equal to F to the M U1 M to the UNM. And now let's look at our assumption. Our assumption says the intersection is trivial. So in other words, this tells us U1 to the UN are multiplicatively independent modulo K. So this is, I don't know whether it's a technical condition, but anyway, in the method we use here, we strongly rely on this condition. So there's no way we can take this out, okay. Okay, so now we have the setup. So we have Bm, and it's a polynomial. This term is a polynomial, and here is U1m to Unm. Okay, so by our assumption, this is this power for infinitely many. Okay, so from the asymptotic, from the Diophantine result we just mentioned, so for each Fm, so when m is fixed, okay, and we plug in U to the M, and if it's big enough, okay, then our Diophantine equation tells us that Fm would be those trivial case. So it would be some constant monomial, depend on M, and then some polynomial to this power. As long as M is sufficiently large, okay. Okay, so now we have a bunch of term. We know it's in this type of form. So how do we conclude that F itself is this type of form? So this is, I think this must be known somewhere, but we give some reproof. So suppose you have a polynomial, which is not kx zero, they are coprime. And suppose you plug in m, they are coprime. So if we have two coprime, and when you specialize, and so for all but finite many, they have to remain coprime. Okay. So in other words, if we know for infinitely many, they are in this type of form. And because you know, originally I write an equation for F, I write down all the irreducible term. And so for infinitely many M, they have to be coprime. And in other words, once you know for infinitely many M, they are in this type of form, then there's only one possibility that this F is in some polynomial times xi times g to this power. Okay. So now we know the F itself is in this type of, and we are actually quite close. So this monomial is always something you can just take an extension, you can heal it. So let's just assume that we don't have that monomial term. Let's look at this term. Okay, so suppose f can be written in some polynomial times g to the this power. And let's assume even further, this is also something can taking care of. So assume case q is monique. And so and also q has no this power. So, okay. Okay, suppose now let's deal with this type of f. So what does this tell us? So you plug, we have infinitely many m, and you plug in m and take u1 to the m, un to the m, and it's simply qm and g to the d. So what does this tell us? So remember, bm is this power, okay, and here is this power. So this tells us qm is also this power for infinitely many n. Okay, so this is really a question. So suppose you have a polynomial, monique, this power 3, and suppose you take infinitely many constant such that it's this power. So is it q to be a this power, or it's so q has to be constant coefficient because it's not. It's this power 3. So in that case, Q must be constant coefficient. So this is Bush's problem. And the result just tell us, in this case, Q must have a constant coefficient. Okay. So sorry, it seems to go very fast. I will save a lot of time for questions. So finally, just let me recall what is generalized nth power problem. So this is a joint work of Paston and me. So our result is the following. So this is a more complicated form. So if you have m is bigger than this number, and now you start with some polynomial, which is not constant coefficient, monique degree n. So you can factor out polynomial with the constant coefficient part. And this part is no constant coefficient. Okay. And then let's further. So H is a polynomial with no constant coefficient term. And then let's take out the monique irreducible vectors. And suppose they are written in this type of form. Okay. Now, suppose we have some mu, which is larger than every ej, okay? And let's find some distinct element from constant. And so the question is the following. So if you are looking at this polynomial, you take ai, and at every point, they have a large multiplicity. Say the multiplicity is divisible by this large number. So our theorem says in this case, you don't have much choice. In this case, H would be simply equal to product of J equal to L, GJ to the mu's power. So in other words, in our previous case, because we assume G to be this power 3, so it cannot be in this form. So therefore, this H must be constant. And so in other words, you have only this constant part. So this is how to apply this theorem to this power, to this piece of this roots conjecture. So, wow. I think this is the last page of my slide. So maybe I can spend some time for questions.